Amelia Earhart's life was a triumph of bravery and publicity. By her 30s, she had found fame with an array of spectacular flying feats. The American Flyer was gutsy, single-minded, and opened new horizons for women.
Women must try to do things as men have tried. When they fail, their failure must be but a challenge to others.
But her achievements weren't all they seemed.
Amelia wasn't the best woman pilot. She was the best publicized pilot.
She was the product of an unrivaled marketing machine that would make her feel like a fraud. Because of this, she would embark upon one of the most dangerous challenges ever attempted by man or woman. Determined to live up to her heroine status, Amelia's adventurous spirit and unquestioned courage would take her to the limits.
That is astonishing, that she should have lunged across the Pacific, not having covered all eventualities.
It was a journey that would ultimately cost her her life. This is the story of Amelia Earhart, the heroine who couldn't live up to her ambition. The most famous female aviator in history was born in 1897. Amelia Earhart and her younger sister Muriel's childhood was spent enjoying the wealth of their mother Amy's parents.
Amelia's grandfather was a successful judge, highly respected member of the community. And so while she was living with her grandparents, they lived in one of the biggest houses in Atchison, Kansas, in the Midwest.
Amelia's young life was a fairly happy one.
She was very close to her father, who sort of spoiled her in many ways. Amelia was a bit of a tomboy. I think possibly that's why she was closer to her father, who encouraged her. He bought her a little air rifle to clear the barn of rats. She was just a tomboy.
She was also fiercely independent. When she graduated from school in 1916, Amelia boycotted the ceremony and celebrations. Her class photo was captioned, "The girl in brown who walks alone." In 1917, in the midst of World War I, 20-year-old Amelia visited Toronto, Canada. The sight of wounded men returning from the trenches in France made her determined to play a part in the war effort. Throughout the summer of 1918, Amelia worked long hours as a voluntary aid detachment nurse.
That was really a sort of lackey around the wards. I mean, this wasn't a glamorous job. This was cleaning up, looking up, you know, holding a sick bowl for young men, helping remove their soiled dressings. You know, it was hard work, and she worked hard.
After the war, Amelia enrolled as a student at Columbia University in New York, taking courses in chemistry and biological sciences. And true to character, she was photographed climbing to the top of the university library, dressed in a full-length skirt and hat. But she wouldn't last a year. Her parents' marriage was in turmoil due to her father's faltering career and alcoholism. Amelia's father, Edwin, persuaded his family to join him as they attempted to start afresh in Los Angeles. With her education sacrificed and a troubled home life, Amelia found an extraordinary means of escape.
She was taken to a fly-in by her father, just a day, you know, where they saw aeroplanes, these very rare things. Don't forget the 20s. Flying had only been around 10 years. And as soon as she saw an aeroplane, she thought, I want to do that.
After taking a host of part-time jobs, in 1921, Amelia took up flying lessons and became hooked. So much so, she even bought a plane. Purchased shortly before her 24th birthday, it was bright yellow, and she named it the Canary.
I think that the plane cost something like $700, her first aeroplane.
Her mother actually put money into the kitty. The attitude of her parents and her family, her sister as well, was really extremely unusual. Even today, families will be opposed to their daughters or sisters flying.
Her obsession with flying grew, and it fed her passion for daring and adventure. She later wrote,
"Whether it was considered the thing to do or not was irrelevant. As a little girl, I had ridden my buggy in the stable. I'd once climbed up on a delivery horse. I'd jumped over a fence that no boy my age had dared to jump. And I knew there was more fun and excitement in life than I would have time to enjoy."
In 1924, Amelia moved to New York. She took up several teaching posts before finding a job as a social worker in Boston. Her expensive flying habit had had to take a back seat. But an event was about to electrify the world.
For Lindbergh, oh, what a flying fool was he. Lindbergh, his name will live in history.
In 1927, former U.S. airmail pilot Charles Lindbergh made the first solo, non-stop flight from New York to Paris in his single-engine plane, the Spirit of St. Louis. Achieved in a time of 33 hours and 30 minutes, his prize was a massive $25,000. The challenge had already claimed the lives of several pilots, so Lindbergh's achievement made him an instant hero. Lindbergh's feat reawakened Amelia's passion and need for adventure. By early 1928, Amelia had resumed flying, and she'd started to get column inches in the local Boston newspapers. She quickly caught the attention of one particular man, George Palmer Putnam. 40-year-old Putnam had cornered the market in adventure books. With a very successful background in journalism and publishing, he'd quickly secured the rights to Lindbergh's book. Female pilots, including German Thea Rascher, were jostling for the chance to become the first woman to cross the Atlantic, knowing that success would bring instant international fame and riches. The lives of two women had already been claimed by the end of 1927, and more would follow. But it didn't stop others coming forward, willing to give it a crack. In an era where female aviators were rare and often beautiful and glamorous, Putnam recognized the money-making potential and wanted one. Luckily for him, Amelia was already considering the challenge.
He didn't see this really as a woman flying the Atlantic. He saw this as a bestseller. Amelia was asked to go and see him in his office. He was busy with something else when she arrived, and he kept her waiting. And afterwards he recalled that she was very sore about that, and she was as sore as a wet hen for having been kept waiting. So she wasn't frightfully impressed with this man who was too busy to see her. But I think the second or third meeting she realised that there was a lot more to George than she'd seen initially.
George wasn't just impressed with Amelia's feistiness, he was also taken with her looks. In fact, Putnam was immediately struck with her similarity to Lindbergh.
There was an extraordinary physical resemblance between them, particularly when she was dressed in a flying coat and a flying helmet. She looked very like him.
Putnam was convinced he'd found the perfect candidate to fly the Atlantic, and the perfect marketing angle.
In his publicity handouts, I'm quite sure he slipped in this title, Lady Lindy, because very soon afterwards, the newspapers started calling her, referring to her as Lady Lindy.
But Putnam downplayed one particular detail. Amelia wouldn't actually be flying the plane. With no multi-engine flying experience, she'd have to be content with being a passenger. The actual flying would be done by two men, the experienced Wilmer Stultz and flight engineer Lou Gordon. On the morning of the 3rd of June 1928, the trio climbed into the Friendship, a tri-motor Fokker seaplane, and the crew set off from Boston en route to Newfoundland. The final destination was to be Southampton, England. Meanwhile, the Putnam publicity wagon swung into action. The New York Times described Amelia as looking more like Lindbergh than Lindbergh himself, praising her striking physique and flying skills. It even suggested that Amelia was the greatest woman aviator in the country, despite the fact she wasn't actually piloting the plane. Instead, Amelia sat crouched in the rear of the plane, writing in her logbook under instruction from Putnam. Only if the conditions were good enough would she be allowed to take the controls. But atrocious weather throughout would prevent it. She would later admit that she was genuinely frightened. As the aircraft dropped to avoid a storm, she recorded in her log.
Slow descent first. It takes a lot to make my ears hurt. 5,000 feet now. Awfully wet. Water dripping in window. Port motor coughing. Sounds as if all motors are cutting. Bill opens her wide to try to clear. Sounds rotten on the right.
After an eventful 20 hours and 40 minutes in the air, the journey finally came to an end. But not in Southampton.
When they saw land come, they had no idea where they were, but they could land, and that's what they did. They found a sheltered cove, they put down, they landed, they found they were in a little village called Burryport in South Wales.
Locals were initially puzzled by the impromptu arrival. But as word of Amelia's landing quickly spread, a crowd of 2,000 gathered to share the historic moment. The three were brought ashore and spent the night before taking off the next morning for their intended destination. There was an impressive reception in Southampton, but for all the hype, to Amelia, the achievement felt hollow.
Out of the corner of her eye, she could see Stultz and Gordon hanging around on the fringe of things, not knowing what to do. you know. And she was trying all the time to bring them into it, but they wouldn't. I think they probably had instructions from George, George Putnam, you know, that the glory had to be Amelia's.
In the coming days, Amelia's name was flashed around the world. In London, she was feted by the great and the good. Special guest at a luncheon given by the Women's Committee of the British Empire, Amelia was seated between Lady Astor and Winston Churchill. But the reception in the States was even greater. She was greeted with a civic parade in New York. But considering Amelia hadn't even touched the controls, the triumph was of publicity rather than personal achievement. Now she was determined to make a name for herself on merit. So she racked up a host of flying feats.
She was flying from coast to coast to get records. She was trying to win air races. She was trying to set time records from city to city.
In 1929, Amelia helped form the 99s, the first pilots' association for women, named after its total membership, and became its first president. In 1930, she set the women's world flying speed record of 181.18 miles per hour. Amelia's father passed away that same year, but she found comfort with George Putnam. It was clear that over the 2 years, the pair had become more than friends. Putnam's wife had already conceded that Amelia had won her husband's affection and left him.
I don't think Amelia was expecting George to propose marriage. I don't know. I think she was such a modern person in outlook. She was quite happy for their relationship to go on being what it was. George was a romantic at heart. Amelia wasn't a romantic. I think she was a very pragmatic person. And I think probably her initial reaction was, why? You know, why should we bother?
After numerous proposals, in 1931, Amelia finally accepted.
On their wedding day, he was handed a letter saying, okay, I'll marry you, but I want you to know I'm not going to hold you to any medieval code of faithfulness, and nor do I expect to be similarly bound.
You must know again my reluctance to marry, my feeling that I shatter thereby chances in work which mean most to me. I feel the move just now as foolish as anything I could do. I must extract a cruel promise, and that is you will let me go in a year if we find no happiness together. I will do my best in every way and give you that part of me you know and seem to want.
A lot of bridegrooms would be very shocked to get a letter like that from their bride on the day of the wedding. But George being George, he accepted it. He kept Amelia on a very loose rein, and that suited her.
The simple marriage ceremony took place in George's mother's garden in Connecticut. Amelia wore a simple brown suit and cream blouse and was presented with a borrowed ring, which she would never again wear after that day.
I think at first she probably saw it as a business arrangement. You know, business was business. But I think deep down she did love him. She needed George.
In December 1930, Amelia had become the first woman to fly an autogyro. A cross between an aeroplane and a helicopter, the aircraft was deemed unstallable, but took a lot of skill to fly. In 1931, she set an unofficial altitude record of 18,415 feet. Amelia was a dab hand, and George engineered an opportunity. When Amelia completed the first solo transcontinental flight in an autogyro later that year, it was emblazoned with the Beech Nut Packing and Food Company logo, part of a lucrative marketing deal. By now, it was a familiar routine. 3 years before, George had secured a deal for Amelia to endorse Lucky Strike cigarettes, even though she didn't smoke.
If there was one thing George knew about, it was marketing and PR. He arranged lecture tours for her, interviews for her. She had to record every step of the way on her flights. So books were published under her name, articles, interviews. So she was a huge personality.
But for all this apparent success, Amelia knew her achievements fell short. In 1930, English aviator Amy Johnson had gained worldwide recognition when she became the first woman to fly the 11,000-mile journey alone from Britain to Australia in her gypsy moth, Jason.
It suddenly occurred to her that she had acquired her fame on a false premise, that she was famous for being the first woman to fly across the Atlantic, but in fact she hadn't been the first woman to fly across the Atlantic.
Amelia had recently bought a red single-engined Lockheed Vega and was keen to test it to its limits. Her plan was to cross the Atlantic, this time landing in Paris.
It was unfinished business for her. I think she felt a bit of a fraud. And I guess she knew that if she didn't do it solo, somebody else would always take the credit for it. So it had to be solo, and she had to prove she could do it.
After a stage managed and slightly awkward moment with George.
Well, you're off, eh? How's it looking there?
Everything is ready.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Oh, I don't have that for
hot. Amelia departed on the 20th of May 1932, ahead of a 2,000-mile flight across the Atlantic. For all her fame, Amelia was still inexperienced, with surprisingly few flying hours behind her. And like her previous crossing, the conditions were treacherous.
Awful weather, terrible weather. Her book detailing the details of that flight, the mechanical problems that she had, where her exhaust pipe, you know, split and she had naked flames within a foot of a leaking petrol pipe. I mean, you can imagine, can't you, how terrifying that must have been.
She also had trouble with the Vega's rudimentary navigational aids.
She had no idea when dawn broke, what the land was in front of her. But she landed anyway, and it turned out to be a pasture in Northern Ireland. It was a long way off Paris. In fact, had she been another 5 degrees, you know, off, she'd have flown up into the North Sea and never been seen again.
Amelia was some 200 miles off course, and once again found herself amid surprised locals. She then flew on to London and Paris, and again was the centre of attention.
Well, it was a great pleasure for me to be here in England. I really had no objective when I started. I just wanted to come across and justify my previous coming.
But it was back home in the States, Amelia would get a real idea of the extent of her Putnam-starred celebrity.
The Ladybird's home, and the big town's trying to show her that it thinks a whole lot of Amelia Earhart. England and France and Italy and the others were marvelous to the famous woman flyer, but she's back home with her own people now. And after all, home's best.
In celebration of her exploits, she became the first woman to be awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross. 5 years ago.
There's nothing they like more, that the public like more, than a homespun heroine who's also down to earth and could be the girl next door. So she did achieve huge fame, and of course with fame comes rubbing shoulders with presidents and stars and other major personalities.
Amelia's success caught the eye of rising politician and aviation enthusiast Franklin D. Roosevelt.
I, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
Following his inauguration in 1933, Amelia became an occasional guest at the White House. She even treated Eleanor Roosevelt, herself a frustrated aviator, to an impromptu night flight over Washington. Amelia's profile was sky high, and she and George made the most of it. She marketed her own range of luggage and even designed her own clothing collection. And she would lend her talents to an even more lucrative cause.
Initially in the United States, people were a bit wary about flying because they really were genuinely frightened of airplanes crashing. Amelia genuinely saw the future of aviation as something for the masses.
In Europe, Amelia had seen the extent to which air travel was flourishing as a viable business and as a convenient means of public transportation. But in the 1920s and early 1930s, Americans still heavily relied on the rail system to travel large distances. By the mid-30s, Amelia was spearheading the campaign for change. She started working with Lindbergh on a transcontinental air service, the forerunner of TWA, and worked hard to promote Boston Maine Airways, a fledgling airline in which George was a principal stockholder. It wouldn't take long for air travel in the US to prosper, as America entered the golden age of air travel. Meanwhile, Amelia's own flying achievements continued to accumulate. She chased coast-to-coast records and flew from Mexico City to New York. And in 1935, Amelia successfully completed a flight from Hawaii to California. After the 2,408-mile journey, Amelia's Red Vega bounced into Oakland Airport. A crowd of more than 3,000 were there to greet her.
Another national heroine, Amelia Earhart Putnam, won new plaudits with her flight from Hawaii to Oakland. She became the first to solo across the Pacific.
But even this apparent groundbreaking achievement was overhyped by George's promotion.
Well, it was 19 hours and a few minutes. I don't know just exactly how many. I estimated that it would be 19 hours and 9 minutes. I think I hit it just about right. You mean...
George's publicity campaign boasted that Amelia had become the only person to fly solo across both the Pacific and Atlantic Oceans. But she hadn't flown across the Pacific. She had, in fact, only flown a third of it.
Amelia Earhart's about to introduce you to a new thrill for the air-minded. A parachute tower constructed...
George continued the hype.
...for training in parachute jumping. And there she goes up for a trial hop.
The camera-shy Amelia was never placed far away from a good photo opportunity.
And there she comes, shooting the works. Now, ain't that something?
May I have your name, please?
My name's Amelia Earhart.
And your occupation?
I'm a flyer.
Once again, Amelia recognized a gap between people's perception of her and her actual accomplishments.
There were a lot of women doing amazing things, flying through Africa, over desert, over jungle. Jean Batten was creating a huge stir. She was the first person ever to fly from London to New Zealand. So that was a phenomenal achievement.
Amelia wasn't the best woman pilot. She was the best publicised pilot.
In 1931, American pilot Wiley Post and his navigator, Harold Gatty, completed a round-the-world trip in 8 days, 15 hours and 51 minutes. Two years on, Post repeated the feat alone, replacing his navigator with a compass and beating his own time by 21 hours. Amelia knew that a round-the-world flight would validate her profile as America's greatest female flyer.
I don't think Amelia did things to outdo other women. Strangely, I don't get the feeling that she was hugely competitive. If so-and-so is doing this, I must do that. I still get the impression she was pitting herself against herself.
By 1936, Amelia was planning her own record-breaking trip. Unlike Post, who had taken the shortest northern route, Amelia wanted to fly around the widest point of the Earth, flying as close to the equator as possible. It was a massive undertaking, and she'd need a special aircraft. In 1935, Amelia had become a consultant at Purdue University in the Department for the Study of Careers for Women. That year, Purdue put forward a donation of $80,000, enabling Amelia to purchase a Lockheed Electra. The 12-seat twin-engine, all-metal plane was well-equipped for long-distance flying. But even so, the distance across the Pacific Ocean was formidable. The Electra would have to fly to its maximum fuel capacity and beyond. She would need military-scale help. In November 1936, Amelia wrote to her friend, FDR.
Dear Mr. President, for some months, Mr. Putnam and I have been preparing for a flight which I hope to attempt, probably in March. Roughly, it is from San Francisco to Honolulu, Honolulu to Brisbane, as far west as Karachi, across Central Africa to Dakar, Dakar to Natal, and then to New York. The chief problem is the jump westward to Honolulu. I am discussing with the Navy a possible refueling in the air over Midway Island.
With her publisher husband, George Palmer Putnam, Amelia Earhart tested out her newest plane. The flight she proposed to make is one that has never been accomplished, round the world by the equator.
But both the Navy and her good friend and aviation pioneer, Eugene Vidal, weren't confident that Amelia was a skilled enough pilot to refuel in the air. Instead, they suggested Howland Island as a viable refueling stop. A small, uninhabited atoll, Howland was halfway between Australia and Hawaii. Only half a mile wide and a mile and a half long, the Navy agreed to build a runway on it, especially for Amelia. The only difficulty for her would be finding it in the vastness of the Pacific Ocean.
She wanted to do it initially solo. Eventually, she was talked out of that by her advisors. George, who was very nervous about the whole thing, other people that she consulted said, no, she would have to have a navigator with her. The navigator that she chose was Fred Noonan.
he had to be in there. I mean, he was such an experienced navigator. I mean, he'd come from a sea background, he'd come from a merchant background. That was his, you know, he got up to officer status and he'd done well. But his navigation skills were excellent.
The flight was set for March 1937. But after only the first leg, the trip was abandoned following an accident on takeoff in Hawaii. George publicly laid the blame on a burst tire, though others suspected pilot error.
He had been brought back, crated up, and rebuilt. I think initially she thought that that was probably going to be the end of that particular record-breaking attempt. But money was found by Purdue University to rebuild the aeroplane.
The new takeoff date was set for the end of May. But Amelia and her team decided to reverse the route, flying the opposite way around the globe in an attempt to avoid adverse weather. The tiny island of Howland would now be the penultimate stop over the last stretch of the journey, though it meant flying against prevailing winds. By now, George was genuinely nervous about his wife's safety on such a colossal trip. But he had been persuaded that this would be her last big challenge. Days before her departure, Amelia had told a friend,
"I have a feeling there is just about one more flight left in my system and I hope this is it. Anyway, when I finish this job, I mean to give up long-distance stunt flying."
While awaiting the departure date in their California hotel, Amelia and George hammed it up for the cameras.
"How about taking me along?"
"Well, gasoline is really more valuable than you are on a long flight."
"You mean that 180 pounds of gasoline you figure would be more useful than 180 pounds of husband?"
"You guessed right."
If George was concerned about the flight, he knew Amelia well enough to realise he was powerless to change her mind. On the 1st of June 1937, Amelia and navigator Noonan set off from Miami following their transcontinental flight from Oakland, California. Another 27,000 miles of flying lay ahead. Her new route would take her from Miami to Brazil, across the Atlantic to Dakar, over the deserts of Africa to stops in India, Singapore, Australia, and New Guinea, before the island hop back to the States.
They were all long legs of flying, not much rest in between. When she landed, hours and hours and hours would be taken up refueling, which had to be strained through chamois leather to make sure there were no bits in there, you know, that could stop the engine in mid-flight. And the refueling would take anything up to 10 to 12 hours.
Amelia stayed in regular written contact with her husband. From Karachi, she wrote,
"I wish you were here. So many things you would enjoy. Perhaps someday we can fly together to some of the remote places of the world. Just for fun."
There were frequent hazards. On taking off for Burma on the 17th of June, Amelia wrote,
"That takeoff was precarious, perhaps as risky as any we had. The plane clung for what seemed like ages to the heavy, sticky soil before the wheels finally lifted, and we cleared with nothing at all to spare the fringe of trees at the aerodrome's edge."
Monsoons and lengthy repairs to the Electra often delayed the journey. But on the 29th of June, Amelia and Noonan reached Leh, Papua New Guinea, having completed 22,000 miles of their journey. The remaining 7,000-mile passage across the Pacific would bring the greatest challenge yet. Amelia wrote her last commissioned article for the Herald Tribune.
Lockheed stands ready for longest hop weighted with gasoline and oil to capacity. This evening I look eastward over the Pacific. I shall be glad when we have the hazards of its navigation behind us.
On the 2nd of July, loaded with more than 1,000 gallons of gasoline, the Electra made its final departure from Leh.
It went to the very end of the runway and then dropped to the end of the runway and just skipped over the waves as it took off. She couldn't have had any more fuel in that aeroplane.
It would be 2,556 miles to Howland Island. After that, Honolulu and the final Pacific hop stood between them and the greatest ever achievement in aviation history. Noonan would use his chronometer, octant, drift sight, and compass to guide them there. But right from the start, there were problems.
Howland Island was an accident waiting to happen. The chances were against her making that landfall with the navigational aids that were available to them. I mean, look at what happened when she was aiming for Paris and she ended up in Ireland.
Amelia and Noonan had also been given outdated information about the wind. The pair had worked out that Howland would be reached in a little over 18 hours. But with the actual wind speed being 10 knots stronger than they had been told, the flight could take anything up to an hour longer. Then the weather conditions deteriorated, causing difficulty for Noonan.
He was navigating by the stars. Now, if you then fly into a storm, where are the stars? They've gone. And that makes celestial navigation an impossibility.
Amelia did what she could to fly the Electra efficiently. But there was an even bigger problem.
Kilo Hotel Alpha, Quebec, Quebec. Do you read?
It had been pre-planned that the crew of the US Coast Guard clipper, Itasca, would guide her to the island.
Kilo Hotel Alpha, Quebec, Quebec.
But neither Amelia or Noonan had a good understanding of the relatively new use of radio navigation.
It certainly didn't help that neither of them were expert at radio, and neither of them were good at Morse. That is astonishing, that she should have lunged across the Pacific, not having covered all eventualities. I mean, the golden rules in aviation: aviate, navigate, communicate. Those are the three things that will keep you alive. And you really have to be expert at all three.
To keep the Electra as light as possible, vital radio equipment, including an aerial for the relaying of Morse code, had been left behind. But the Itasca continued to use Morse code for 90% of their communication. It would mean information about the changing conditions was transmitted to the pair, but never received.
Kilo Hotel Alpha, Quebec, Quebec. Do you read?
To make matters worse, the frequencies Amelia used weren't suited to direction finding. And she was working to Greenwich Mean Time, while the Itasca used US Navy time, creating a 30-minute discrepancy in their schedules. To cap it all, direction finder equipment on Howland Island wasn't working because of a low battery. At 7:42 a.m. local time, over 19 hours after she left Leh, the Itasca received a message from Amelia.
We must be on you, but cannot see you. Gas is running low. Being unable to reach you by radio. We are flying at altitude 1,000 feet.
Well, they're now beginning to ask themselves some severe questions. You know, where is the boat? We can't see it. Where is the island? We can't see that. Are we where we thought we are?
At 7:58 a.m., another message from Amelia was received.
We are circling, but cannot hear you. Go ahead on 7500.
There's a limit to how far you can go. You do not want to keep lunging forward into the wild blue yonder, not knowing where you're going, or what's there, or if you're in the right place. Must have been terrifying.
Kilo Hotel Alpha, Quebec, Quebec, do you read?
45 minutes later, the Itasca picked up another message from the Electra.
We're on the line of positioning 157337. We'll repeat this on 6210 kilocycles. We are running north and south.
This message would be Amelia's last. With no island or reef, or water less than 30 feet deep within 350 miles of Howland Island, the likelihood is that shortly after 8:43 a.m., Amelia was forced to ditch the plane. And the Electra would almost certainly have broken up during a high-speed landing on water. Based on the strength of the messages received by the Itasca, it is believed that Amelia was within 100 miles of Howland when she disappeared.
On the last lap of her magnificent flight round the world by way of the equator, Miss Amelia Earhart was lost in mid-ocean. On the 2,500-mile hop to Howland Island, she was reported missing.
The United States helped a great deal. It was the biggest, air-sea search ever mounted.
The search, heavily funded by George Putnam, covered 250,000 square miles and continued for more than 2 weeks. But neither Amelia, Noonan, or the plane were ever seen again. Many events seem to have contributed to Amelia's disappearance. Maps published the previous month revealed Howland was actually 6 miles further east than given on Amelia's charts.
The Itasca made mistakes, Amelia made mistakes. There wasn't this understanding of, it seems to me, how critical that leg was. I don't know whether people just assumed that Fred Noonan was so good that he would find Howland Island, and that Amelia was so good that she would get there.
Amelia wasn't officially declared dead until January 1939. In the aftermath, a whole host of conspiracy theories emerged. Some claimed that Amelia was living as a castaway on an island in the Pacific. Others suggested that she had survived and been taken prisoner.
There were a lot of Japanese-occupied islands around at the time. So suddenly she was captured by the Japanese, executed on this island, executed on that island. Even a crazy story about somebody seeing her working as a prostitute for servicing Japanese soldiers.
It was even claimed that Amelia had been working as a spy for Roosevelt, using her flight to secretly photograph Japanese territories before being safely returned to the United States and given a new identity. In 1970, a former pilot, Irene Bolam, was forced to publicly refute claims she was the missing flyer.
Well, I'm not Amelia Earhart. And I think anyone who attempts to make capital out of such a fine person is using a very poor approach to life.
The human need for a conclusion to the unexplained mystery of Amelia and Noonan's fate has seen frequent sea searches for the missing Electra and numerous islands scoured for traces of evidence. The mystery continues to this day as investigations throw up more and more possibilities. But Amelia's legacy remains a profound and complex one.
okay, one can feel gutted that she lost her life, but you need people like that who are prepared to say, well, we'll pay the ultimate price for pushing those boundaries.
Amelia Earhart may have benefited from the power of publicity, but the easygoing, modest girl next door made a long-lasting connection with people. And her pioneering achievements have ensured that her appeal endures.
Anybody who talks about the 99s, the first thing they'll mention is Amelia Earhart, and that's still today. There was a challenger in her, the adventurous spirit in her, and a damn good pilot.
The odd thing about Amelia's legacy is it isn't really tied up in aviation. Aviation is there, but Amelia's legacy isn't that. Amelia is seen as a woman who tries and succeeds. She is a role model for the young people today. Here is a girl who took on something that was a man's preserve. She succeeded at it.
In her last letter to her husband, Amelia wrote,
"Please know that I am quite aware of the hazards. I want to do it because I want to do it. Women must try to do things as men have tried. When they fail, their failure must be but a challenge to others.